This is Adventist World Radio Ghana.
Voice of Hope.
AWR Ghana. Voice of Hope. Voice of
Hope. This is Daylight Magazine, and under this segment, we have Reflections,
Youth Corner,
and Moment of Truth.
I am Kwejo Ansedu, and I'm presenting this with
Hannah B. Nyakun.
How are you doing today, Hannah?
I'm doing well, and you?
I'm doing well as well. I hope, dear listener, you enjoy our programs. Stay tuned.
AWR Ghana, Voice of Hope. Voice of Hope.
All the way, my Savior leads me. What have I to ask beside? Can I doubt His tender mercy, who through life has been my guide? Heavenly peace, divinest comfort, here by faith in Him to dwell. For I know whate'er befall me, Jesus doeth all things well. For I know whate'er befall me, Jesus doeth all things well.
All the way my Savior leads me, choose each winding path I tread. Gives me grace for every trial, feeds me with the living bread. Oh, my weary steps may fall.
Oh, do you have a mirror image? I hope you do. Come join me as we take a purposeful contemplation of our lives. This is the program Reflection.
Dear listener, the title of our message for today is Hope Delayed but Not Terminated. Our memory text is taken from Galatians chapter 4, verse 4 and 5. Galatians chapter 4, verse 4 and 5. When the fullness of time had come, God sent His Son to redeem those who were under the law, so that we might receive adoption in Eden. When Adam and Eve first heard the promise, they looked for its speedy fulfillment. They joyfully welcomed their firstborn son, hoping that he might be the deliverer. But the fulfillment of the promise tarried. Those who first received it died without the sight. From the days of Enoch, the promise was repeated through patriarchs and prophets, keeping alive the hope of his appearing, and yet he came not. The prophecy of Daniel revealed the time of his advent, but not all rightly interpreted the message. The hand of the oppressor was heavy upon Israel, and many were ready to exclaim, "The days are prolonged, and every vision faileth." But like the stars in the vast circuit of the appointed path, God's purposes know no haste and no delay. Through the symbols of the great darkness and the smoking furnace, God had revealed to Abraham the bondage of Israel in Egypt, and had declared that the time of their sojourning should be 400 years. Afterward, He said, "Shall they come out with great substance?" Against that word, all the power of Pharaoh's proud empire battled in vain. On the selfsame day appointed in that divine promise, it came to pass that all the host of God went out from the land of Egypt. So in heaven's council, the hour for the coming of Christ had been determined. When the great clock of time pointed to that hour, Jesus was born in Bethlehem. When the fullness of the time was come, God sent forth His Son. Providence had directed the movement of nations and the tide of human impulse and influence until the world was ripe for the coming of the Deliverer. The nations were united under one government. One language was widely spoken and was everywhere recognized as the language of literature. From all lands, the Jews of the dispersion gathered to Jerusalem to the annual feast As these return to the places of their sojourn, they could spread throughout the world the tidings of the Messiah's coming. While few understood the nature of Christ's mission, there was a widespread expectation of a mighty prince who would establish his kingdom in Israel and who would come as a deliverer to the nations. Amen. Today's devotional was written by Ellen G. White and was presented by Emmanuel Abrefumensa.
This segment is about the youth and their lives in today's world. The program is Youth Corner.
Aimlessly beneath the barren sky, leave it to me, I lead you home. So afraid that you will not be found, it won't be long before your sun goes down. Just leave it to me, I'll lead you on.
You're welcome to the program Youth Corner with me, Andrew Bwatin Bexim. We are still continuing with the stages of development, and we have again at the studios students from the Department of Development Studies who are in their third years, the first being
Paul Manson Augustin,
Reynolds Adulabi,
Maurice Nejapon.
You're all welcome.
Thank you.
My name is Andrew Bwatin Bexim. Today we're looking at the fourth stage out of the five stages of development, according to Mr. Walter Rostow, an American economic analyst. Now, the fourth stage is drive to maturity.
Yeah.
Yes. And Rose, drive to maturity. What are we driving?
Okay.
Yeah.
As the name itself, drive to maturity.
Yeah.
You know what? When you say somebody is matured,
mm-hmm.
you know what it is.
Yes.
So this is highly developed society.
Okay.
Where the old leading aim of development remains to increase largely in per capita income.
Okay.
And productivity of the people.
Mm.
So this stage remains for 40 to 50 years after the takeoff stage.
Mm.
So in this stage, the economic growth rate is very, very high.
Mm.
And the standard of living of the people, too, is better. Should I say better? I don't know the way to give it, but
okay.
Here, they don't suffer.
They
don't suffer.
Okay.
Because the standard of living is very good.
Okay.
And there is large increase in personal and national income,
mm.
as we all know.
Mm.
And the rate of investment is about 20%.
Okay.
We saw earlier on that. Our previous discussion,
mm-hmm.
we said the takeoff stage, the investment rate is 10%.
Yeah.
So this stage, they've been able to increase their investment rate up to 20%, meaning that the GDP of the country
has doubled.
Is doubled.
Mm-hmm.
So they'll have a better standard of living.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Got it.
Okay. What I want to add to what my sister just said,
mm-hmm.
is that we can categorize or talk about this stage based on two main features.
Okay.
As she said, the first one is industrialization.
Yeah.
At this stage, the country is fully industrialized.
Mm.
All aspects of industrialization, all the manufacturing sectors. I read the top 10 developed countries,
mm-hmm.
and they were mentioning U.S., Ireland, and those countries.
Yeah.
And the major criteria was per capita income.
Mm.
Okay. And the first one was having like 43 point something dollars,
mm-hmm.
as to a person, the per capita income.
Wow.
And it was just, it followed like that. So the two major features they used to describe these stages,
mm-hmm.
the industrialization and the per capita income.
Okay.
Okay, at this stage, the country is economically developed.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and they also diversified.
Okay.
When you take the industrial sectors, the manufacturing sector and all the other, and the service sector, they are really developed.
Okay.
Okay, so that is the major two features they are using.
Okay, Ronald.
Okay, to add to what my colleagues also said, let's take this for example. Let's say you have a daughter who is in her 18s and 20s with certain features.
Well, I don't have one, so I mean, maybe I know what features you're talking about.
With certain
maybe the features I'm having.
Features.
Oh, okay. Mm.
Then one could look at the lady and say, yeah, this lady is assured enough to be married or something.
Okay.
The same way when we compare an economy, as in a drive to maturity.
Mm-hmm. There's certain features that suggest that the nation or the country is matured enough to...
Like,
okay.
Yeah.
That would suggest rules is...
Okay. Yeah.
It's really matured.
Mm.
Could be that there are certain features. Mm. One, we look for technological innovations.
Right.
There is a whole lot of technology going on.
Mm-hmm.
There is a boost in investment.
Mm-hmm.
Where... in all sectors of the economy,
mm-hmm.
they are all flourishing. They are moving on. The institutions are working.
Mm-hmm.
The laws are working.
Mm-hmm.
A whole lot are working. That, we can say, the economy is mature. You know, that's what I can say.
Okay. So when a country experiences such a stage, are there any disadvantages?
Oh, yeah. They are.
Because everything seems to be going on smoothly for them. So, do they have any problems? Do we foresee any problems here?
Yes.
No.
Because I feel that, personally, I don't know, I stand to be corrected, but in a situation where you have a country experiencing this high level of maturity, I think crime will also be on the rise because people would have enough possessions or properties or investments that they have made. And others who are also, of course, you don't expect everybody to be at the same level in the country. You are assessing them by their per capita income.
Yeah.
Per capita income could also mean that there may be a few people in the society who have so much that when that bulk amount is spread over the entire population, you have people who are experiencing high levels of a certain amount of money. But then, I'm sure there are examples of some countries that have high per capita income, maybe Russia or something of that sort. But you have quite a significant amount of the people over there experiencing serious poverty. So that they could, end up committing certain crimes, to break into people's companies, take people's stuff. And I don't know if what I'm saying is...
I think, in a way, you are right.
Hmm.
And this point you are raising will go in to some of the critique of this stage.
Okay. Then maybe we'll look at that one later. So, Rose.
What I'm going to say is quite funny, but that is my opinion.
Oh, it's allowed.
Other countries, more especially the developing countries, will be depending on you.
Oh, yeah. They are always taking from you,
Dependable God. So they all want to get something from you, like as in friends with benefits.
Yeah,
so you also try to help them.
Okay.
And so it's like you wouldn't have this peace of mind. Look, pardon me, but
you're
the country wouldn't have a peace of mind because there will be so many troops in and out trying to get something from you.
I think we'll have to end up this discussion as well because our time is fast spent. So we can continue with the final stage next time we meet. I've been talking to Miss Rose Amoa Ejapong, Mr. Reynolds Adolabi, as well as Mr. Godson Opong Mensah, who are all students from the Department of Development Studies, Valley View University. My name is Andrew Barton-Baxen. We'll see you again next time.
Keep
You can contact us on
Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, send us an email through radio@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058.
God has smiled on me. He has set me free. God has smiled on me. He's been good to me. God has smiled on me. He has set me free. God has smiled on me. He's been good to me.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Cherished listener, this is the moment of truth, where truth is presented with precision and exactness. Enjoy this encounter of a lifetime.
Hello, my dear. I bring you greetings in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. I want us to consider a topic, the ultimate priority. And the verse I want us to read is a verse in the Ten Commandments, Exodus chapter 20, verse 3. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. That is what we have in the Bible. We live in a world of scarcity. So that you do not get everything that you need, you may have a list of 1,000 items and your resources can provide only a few of them. The basic problem that we have is the problem of scarcity. And so economists have come out with the principle of choice. You have to draw what they call a scale of preference. And it is a list of items that show in order of priority the things that you will need. On the scale of preference, you tackle the most important and the most pressing need first. So that if you're a farmer and you need a hoe and a cutlass and maybe insecticide, you've got to get one of them first before the other, depending on your resources. Maybe if you are going to the market, you need tomatoes, you need onions and other ingredients. You need to choose some of them first. And so everybody struggles with the problem of scarcity, and so we need to choose some out of others first. And in the religious line, sometimes or maybe always, we struggle between other alternatives and God. However, we must always learn to attach the first priority to the first thing that we need. Just as the verse I read, Exodus chapter 20, verse 3, thou shalt have no other gods before me. The phrase I want us to consider is before me. This phrase suggests that nothing should be put before God. And so if you are drawing a scale of preference, make sure God is first on your scale of preference. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 33, Jesus admonishes us thus, but seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. The question I want to ask you is, what is it that you have put before God? Someone has put clothing. Someone has put his business. Someone has put houses, property, entertainment. Some has put their spouses and friends. Some even food and even a particular sin before God. But the question is, what have you put before God in your life? People tend to forget what Jesus also said in Luke chapter 14, verse 26. He says that if any man come to me and hates not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. When you want to follow Christ, you have to forsake all your relatives, your work, anything that will lead you away from God has to be left, so that you will always remember to put God first. In the Bible, we have examples of people who decided to put God first. Daniel decided against his life to sleep among lions just because he wanted to stand for God. He had God first on his scale of preference. Moses chose to suffer with the Hebrews instead of enjoying the dainties in the palace of Pharaoh. Joseph decided to remain chaste in the house of Potiphar when he was in Egypt. Peter decided to be crucified for the Lord Jesus Christ. He had God first on his scale of preference. Paul decided to remain in chains for the sake of Christ. John was fried in oil, and he was banished to the island of Patmos. The apostles were martyred for the sake of Christ. They had God first on their scale of preference. The question is, what do you have first on your scale of preference? When you are confronted with a matter of choice and God is in, where do you put God? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in Daniel chapter 3 decided to stand for God. They put God as the ultimate priority in deciding who to stand for. King Nebuchadnezzar had made a very big image, a huge image on the plain of Dura, and had asked the whole world to bow. But these three young men, when we read Daniel chapter 3, verses 16 and 17, they say, "Oh, Nebuchadnezzar, we have no need to answer you in this matter. If that is the case, our God whom we serve is able to deliver us from the burning fiery furnace, and he will deliver us from your hand, O king." They stood firm to say that we are not going to bow down to the image which you have set, because we have God first on our scale of preference. God is our ultimate priority. In anything that we do, we remember to do it for God first before we think of any other. Therefore, if anything is conflicting our stand for God, we are not going to bow. They chose to trust in God instead of obeying the king. They chose to die in the fire because the punishment for defiance was being burnt in fire. They chose to die in fire instead of living in sin. They chose to endure pain for God instead of dancing in idolatry. They chose to be different when everybody else was doing it. When all the people had bowed to the image, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego decided to stand for God. They also said in verse 18 that, "But if not, let it be known to you, O king, that we do not serve your gods, nor will we worship that gold image which you have set up." In essence, they were telling the king that even if our God will not deliver us from your fire, we are not going to bow. They just said, "We are going to put God first, even if he will not deliver us, even if it means that we have to die. King, we are ready to die. Even if God will not deliver us, we are still going to remain faithful to him." And you may know the story. If you do not know it, what happened was that the Lord sent intervention. These three young men were bound and put into the fire. But finally, King Nebuchadnezzar saw that the three men that were put turned to four. And he said, "The form of the fourth one is like the Son of God." God had intervened on behalf of his children. His children were supposed to die in fire. The fire was multiplied seven times. And yet, God sent his Son. And I believe that that was Jesus Christ with them. The mighty firefighter was with these three young men in the fire. If you decide to stand for God, if you decide to put God first on your scale of preference, If you decide to make him your ultimate priority in whatever situation you find yourself in, God will surely send intervention. He will intervene on your behalf. He will stand for you too, just like you have stood for him. And at the end, you will be victorious over the devil. The devil will always want you to put God aside and decide on your own. In deciding in business, in your decisions at the home, in whatever decision you make, my caution to you is that always remember to have God as the ultimate priority. Remember, the verse I read is the first of the Ten Commandments. Thou shalt have no other gods before me. Make God your ultimate priority. And that is my prayer for you. God bless you. This is Josiah Andor. God bless you.
This is our address, Adventist World Radio Ghana, Valley View University, P.O. Box AF 595, Adenta, Accra, Ghana, West Africa. Or if you have access to the internet, send us an email through radio@vvu.edu.gh. Or better still, you can call us on 030-7051-058. The number again, 030-7051-058. I am blessed being a part of this program. Hannah, what about you?
The same here.
So I believe, listener, you did too. This has been once again Kwejo Ansendu and
Hannah B. Nyaku.
God bless you.